A very good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning, and our first item of business is pre-budget scrutiny of the Scottish Government's forthcoming budget for 2023 to 2024. And I refer members to papers 1, 2 and 3. And I welcome to the meeting this morning Wendy Sinclair Gibbon, Her Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prisons for Scotland. So a warm welcome, Wendy. So I'd like, if I may, to just move straight into questions. And I'll open up with a very general question, if I may. And it's really just to sort of get your overarching thoughts on the implications of a potential flat cash resource settlement for the next few financial years. So I'm just going to hand straight over to you, Wendy.
Not a problem. First of all, I think it's extremely concerning for the prison service, in fact, for justice overall. But if you think what the prison service do is they hold the most dangerous, the most violent and the most vulnerable people in our society, that's a reality. There's a good proportion that are victims themselves. There's a good proportion that have significant mental health issues. And what we're saying is a flat cash budget, which over 4 years will reduce the overall budget hugely. I'm deeply concerned that many human rights breaches will occur. I'm deeply concerned that we risk a prisoner disturbance. And I'm deeply concerned that staff will be reduced to such an extent that we'll end up with what we would like to call humane containment and not actually protect community safety. Because if you're bringing people into prison and you're then doing nothing with them, you are releasing them back into society angrier than they were when they came in. That's not appropriate. I, as a person in the community, would like to think that the prison service is working with them to reduce the risk when they leave. So I think a flat cash budget has massive implications for society, as well as for the individuals, as well as for the staff.
Thanks very much for that. And I suppose my next question would be a similar overarching question, but specifically in relation to the implications of for the capital budget. So in terms of current and future budgets for the prison service, I'm interested just to get a very general overview from your perspective.
We see an ageing infrastructure in a goodly number of prisons, Barlinnie, Perth, the older ones, Highland, and Dumfries, Greenock is shocking. The reality is, I would not like to think, as a Scottish nation, that we spend a huge amount of money building new prisons to cope. I would much rather that we had a look at radical justice reform and see if we can reduce the population so we can close the old ones and not have to replace the infrastructure. Prisons are hugely expensive. There was a 2002 report which said the cost of recidivism, somebody going back through the courts and into prison, is £200,000. Well, if we can reduce that and we can stop people going to prison, we will save a lot of money. That's not saying that you should in any way stop people going to prison who frankly deserve to be there. But there are ways and means, I think, of reducing our infrastructure to meet demand that is better than we have at the moment.
So I know other members are particularly interested in the issues around capital budget, prison estate. But if I can just ask one follow-up question in relation to that. In terms of the older sections of the prison estate as it stands at the moment, thinking ahead in terms of budget provision going forward into the next year, what are your main concerns about, in particular, that older section, if you like?
Yeah, so there are two prisons that give me considerable concern. One is Greenock, and for those of you who haven't visited Greenock, there are a vast number of cells that are out of use because the damp comes into the prisons and makes them uninhabitable. They roof there suffers ingress regularly, and they're having to fix and repair. The cost of maintaining Greenock, I think, outweighs its value. It's an expensive site. Mm-hmm. It's a good site. I think there are opportunities to redevelop that would give money back into the prison service. Barlinnie is our biggest prison, and it copes with overspill from every other prison. If there's any other issue, it does the surge in there. The cells are small. I would not like to live 22 hours a day with a total stranger and a tiny cell that they have. Against that, it's well run, it's organised. It costs a fortune to maintain each year because it's old. The plumbing is worrying. I mean, I certainly, when I went there, was stunned by the dilapidation of the basics of the prison. Mm-hmm. Every effort is made to keep the cells and the living areas clean, tidy, well decorated, etc. But, you know, when you walk around at night and a little family of rats goes with you, or you walk down to chaplaincy and the plaster dust lands on your hair, I just think it's a question of time before it actually collapses, and we're then stuck because it's the biggest prison in Scotland. So okay. I do worry about that.
Yeah. Thanks very much. Some stark evidence. So I'm going to just hand straight over to members, and I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill first, and then I'll bring in Katie Clark. So Pauline.
Thank you very much. Good morning. You've spoken about Barlinnie Prison. I've had local regional interest in it. Just to add to what you've said already for the records, there's only 5 cells suitable for disabled prisoners. There are no shared spaces to sit and converse with other prisoners at mealtime. And all meals, I think this is actually quite shocking, that all meals have to be eaten in the prisoners' own cells. And it may, where there's 2 prisoners, breach the standards of space. So not much can be done about that right now, I imagine. But how concerned would you be if the timetable for the new build were to slip? And have you had any discussions that would give cause for concern about the timetable? I appreciate that's in the hands of the Scottish Prison Service, but given what you've said, I imagine you have a strong interest in that as well.
I think there's every possibility it'll slip, basically because it's going to be difficult to source materials and labour to actually manage to meet the timeframes. And that's true of all building projects at the moment. They're certainly managing that well, and the new HMP Glasgow looks quite exciting and future-proofed. So I think that's a good thing. I do hope it doesn't slip, but equally, Barlinnie has been coping. If it does slip, they'll go on coping. You know, so that's the way it is. I don't know if you've looked at the maintenance budget for these old prisons, but it's really quite shocking.
Do you see any other options in the short term other than what you've said, which is you'd find alternatives to prison?
I think if we look at the prison population and we look at executive release and we look at remand and we look at a real radical rethink, I think we can reduce the population considerably, yes.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Pauline. Katie, over to you.
Yes, you particularly picked out Greenock and described the conditions there as shocking. And in your report last year, you said that Greenock was an urgent need for replacement and clearly ill-suited to a modern prison system. But last year, the Cabinet Secretary said that it was unlikely that the Scottish Prison Service would be able to commence replacement before 2025, 2026. Now, our calculations are the kind of cuts we're looking at for the justice sector are in the region of 20% over the coming years. Mm-hmm. So if it was going to be 2025, 2026 last year, it suggests that it could be some time before there's any serious proposals on Greenock. Is that a massive concern, do you think? And what do you think the implications are going to be given the current condition of the prison if there's not substantial investment?
We're going back into Greenock on inspection next March. Mm-hmm. If it's in the same condition as it was at our last inspection, I will be pulling the health and safety executive in with me. Mm-hmm. By the way, it's still one of the best prisons. The staff prisoner mm-hmm. relationships and the things they achieve are really mm-hmm. excellent. Mm-hmm. But it's a small prison. you could actually disperse the prisoners elsewhere. I don't think they'd be very happy about that because they're close to home. But there are possibilities. I think it's a shame that HMP Inverclyde wasn't continued with at the time. So, yeah.
That's very helpful information. And you've said very clearly that you believe there needs to be radical justice reform. Now, politicians in the Scottish Parliament since its creation have been arguing for that. I think it's, you know, fair to say that many politicians in the Scottish Parliament since the creation, indeed before the creation of the Scottish Parliament, were saying that actually there wasn't really a need for a full women's prison in Scotland, that actually that wasn't the right way to dispose of women prisoners, and that for many male prisoners, actually prison wasn't the right way to deal with offending behaviour. Why do you think it is that despite the fact that these debates have been going on for many years and those debates are continuing, that there just hasn't been that kind of radical justice reform you're talking about? Why do you think it's not been possible to drive change in the system? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Many thoughts, some of which aren't polite. I think there is a cultural reluctance. Mm-hmm. You know, we are, as in Scotland, a punitive culture to some degree. I think there is an I-Bean culture. I think there is a reality that it would require significant research to actually look at it. It's very easy to look at Norway and say, look at Halden Prison, to look at Holland and say they reduced their prison population by 40% and decriminalised various drugs. We're not Dutch and we're not Norwegian. We are Scottish. So therefore, there needs to be a justice reform agenda that is particularly suited to us and to no one else. But it's difficult to do when you're firefighting. And the prison service and the justice service has been firefighting for some time. You know, there's a backlog in the courts, there's been overcrowding, never mind the pandemic, never mind the stuff at the moment. But if you look back for the last 10 years, there's been a degree of firefighting. And it's difficult when you're firefighting to stand back and say, what could we do? I mean, I very briefly looked some years ago and said, if we took out all the people in prison who were there for substance use related offending that wasn't violent, wasn't domestic abuse, how many would we get rid of? How many would we reduce by? And given all the kind of current evidence around, you know, seeing substance use as a health problem rather than a criminal problem, that's, you know, that's something to look at. But that kind of deep justice reform needs to be done despite the firefighting, but needs to be Scottish. It really does. You know, we're not. We really need to think about what's best for Scotland. And if we end up thinking having a very high prisoner population is the right way forward, then we have to invest in it.
So, I mean, you said very clearly there's some people that just have to be in prison, the nature of their offending, the nature of what they are as a human being, that their violent nature means they have to be incarcerated. And I think we all accept that's the case. There is a need for prisons. But I think we also believe that there are people in prison really now that shouldn't be there. And what we've been trying to find out is really the data on that in terms of trying to have a better understanding of who's actually in prison and what they're in prison for. How good is our data, would you say? Because that's something that the committee is very interested in terms of trying to actually take a view in terms of what could be achieved in trying to look at other disposals, because clearly there's some people that the only possible disposal is incarceration.
But there are also people there for a place of safety because there is no inpatient bed. There are people there with significant mental health that are identified as needing to be inpatient, but they're held in prison because there are no inpatient beds. There are people there who are repeat offenders time and time and time again for whom prison isn't working, and maybe we need to look at why, you know. I think the data you receive is good. The problem is the justice system isn't digitised and it's not jointly digitised. So it's very hard to see where people come in. I mean, if you look at a simple example, in Polmont, they ask people as they come in if they've ever been care experienced. They then went through a process of ringing all the local authorities that all the young people came from. The care experienced, the people who self-identified as care experienced or were identified by social services on the way in, were about 16%. When they went round the local authorities, it was about 46%. But, you know, how can you judge the data unless you actually do the data mining? So there's a lot of data we don't get. Another good example of that is how many people are out of cell for how many hours a day. In the private sector, they've got like barcodes and computer systems and they go tick, 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 there you are. But that isn't true in the public sector. So actually gathering that is onerous and time consuming. So the data you're receiving isn't wholly accurate, I don't think, and isn't rich enough for you be able to mine it for the information you need.
Yeah, could I just ask one further question? I will be brief. When we've spoken to judges, one of the things they've said is that for women prisoners appearing, in particular women appearing from custody, often the reasons that custodial sentences are given are almost for paternalistic reasons, that there's a view that they don't know quite what else to do. They're not convinced prison is actually the right way to deal with a particular woman offender, but
there's no other option.
There's no other options, and also women tend to get longer sentences for similar offences to men. Have you any thoughts on that? Because obviously prison isn't necessarily the right solution, but also has massive budgetary implications.
Massive, but I absolutely love the new women's custody units. Mm-hmm. I just think they are a step mm-hmm. forward in thinking. Mm-hmm. I would love to see more supervised bail. I'm delighted that we've at last got a family rehab centre. Mm-hmm. There are still some women who need to be in prison, no arguing. Mm-hmm. And that's always difficult to manage. But I do think having a greater degree of cheaper community options mm-hmm. that allows informed decision making and for those decision makers to be able to have options is important. And there's tons of expertise out of there who can advise you more wisely than I can.
Okay, thanks very much, Katie. I'm going to bring in Jamie Green and then I'll bring in Fulton McGregor. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for your written submission. I just want to start, first of all, with a quote from your own submission, and it backs up something that Teresa Medhurst told us last week. You say that it's difficult to avoid the conclusion, I'm paraphrasing, that a flat cash settlement could lead to a rapid deterioration of safety. Teresa Medhurst last week from the Scottish Prison Service said that it would impact on things such as violence and vulnerability. What exactly do you mean by that comment, and what would a flat cash settlement look like in terms of the volatility of prison?
Sure. I think you have to look at the historical research around prison disturbances. And, you know, if you look way back to Learmonth and Woodcock and then to all of the others, what you'll find, Justice Wolfe, the report there is particularly interesting. What you find is a confluence of issues coming together that then explodes. So if you have, for instance, we almost had it, a confluence in January with the potential for industrial relations strike, the potential for the Huawei in-cell phones being removed, the potential for the 300 free minutes being removed, the high cost of living, which means families can't support their ones in prison as well or visitors often, the prisoners' canteen, the bits and pieces they buy for themselves, prices have gone up, the wages won't have gone up. That's a confluence. You then have the confluence on the staff side, where you've got a cost of living increase. We know staff who are working in the prisons are already using food bank. You've got a sense of legitimacy. Is what's happening to us fair? You know, are we getting the same pay rise as the nurses, the police, whatever? And you get the same sense of legitimacy with prisoners. So if you aren't able to run what I would call the extras in the prison, but aren't extras, the offending behaviour programmes, the visits, the you know, the extra gym, the bringing the community groups in, which cost money, what then? You're then going to lose a sense of legitimacy. And if you've got morale low, because frankly staff are tired at the moment, they're exhausted after the pandemic, I think the confluence of all of that almost exactly matches the research which showed that previous prisoner disturbances happened. Now, everybody's working towards making sure that won't happen. Everybody. There's no argument. The amount of work going ahead is huge. But it is a risk, and I think we would be naive to not think of it as a risk.
So just to be clear, what we heard from the Scottish Prison Service and their evidence to us was that a flat cash settlement would mean they would need to revert to near COVID-type lockdown scenarios. Yes. When prison,
yes.
Pretty much getting rid of all of the good stuff that does happen, rehabilitation, third parties, third sector, and ensuring that people come out of prison better than they went in, effectively, and all of that would cease. Yes. to exist. Would that be a concern?
Huge. So if you think of someone who's already volatile, violent and dangerous, you do nothing with them in there, you're going to release them angrier. You know, in terms of community safety, it's a mistake. So.
Sounds worrying. I wanted to touch on two local issues. One is HMP Greenock. As Katie Clark mentioned, it's disappointing. There's no plans for a replacement. I understand these things come at huge capital costs. We learned that the cost of HMP Highland has nearly trebled already in cost, and it probably will rise further. These things do tend to cost a lot more than they initially are estimated, but nonetheless, it sounds to me like things are quite dire in Greenock. Do you, or which other agency, has the ability to shut it down if you're not?
I don't have the power to shut it down. I can recommend it being shut down. That's as far as I can go. I don't have any powers, and I'm not like the care inspectorate.
If you were happy with what you see, in the sense that you feel that was the best option, is that something you would recommend in
happily.
This scenario? You would
happily, yes.
Right.
Unfortunately, happily, yes.
And where would all the prisoners go in that scenario?
There's not that many. I mean, my job is not population management, but you could move the women into Polmont, and you could move the men into a combination of Kilmarnock, Lomas, and Barlinnie.
Right. Not ideal, perhaps.
No, it's not, because it takes them away from their family.
Indeed. The other issue I wanted to question is, there are obviously two private prisons in the estate. What's your general view on what you see when you go into these prisons that are run privately versus publicly? You'll be aware, obviously, the government has chosen to take HMP Kilmarnock, presumably back into public service. One of the things we've struggled with is getting any justification for that decision, and the argument seems to be around cost. However, you said in an earlier answer that we may not have full sight of everything we need in terms of detail. Would you say that HMP Kilmarnock is currently good value for money? What's the situation?
Cheapest prison in Scotland.
Right, so why do you think the government would want to take it back in-house to SPS?
Ideology.
In what respect?
In the sense of having private sector providers run public sector for the public sector, yeah.
Even if they're running a better service more cheaply?
I think that is the ideology. That's what I'm guessing, anyway.
Right.
I have to declare an interest here. I used to be the governor of Kilmarnock,
right.
And I also used to work with Serco. So in terms of HMIPS, we are completely neutral on public or private prisons. We inspect them and do everything exactly the same way. When we inspected Kilmarnock, I recused myself because I felt it was inappropriate that I had... I mean, if it came out with a good report, it would be my fault. If it came out with a bad report, it would be my fault. So, you know.
Understood. But when you go in there, you now have an independent neutral role. You go in and inspect these prisons. What do you see when you go into Addiewell or Kilmarnock?
But just in the middle of doing Addiewell, we'll wait and see. I'd like to wait until we finished the inspection before I made any comment on Addiewell. Mm-hmm. Kilmarnock is well run, well organised, safe, good prison.
Okay, thank you. And my last question at this stage for...
Are you aware of how much it's going to cost to transition it into the public sector?
I'm not, but I'd love to know.
I can only make a wild guess, but I suggest you ask Audit Scotland to look at that. It's certainly in millions.
Would you be prepared to go on the record today with an estimate?
I'd rather not, but I transitioned HMP Blakenhurst back into the English prison service in 2000, and that was between 10 million and 12 million or thereabouts. So.
Right, so it's in the tens of millions. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sure the committee will discuss that in more detail and with the Cabinet Secretary, no doubt. My last point is around women in prisons. You, in your submission, said that women in particular at the extreme end of waiting times, and if necessary, requiring high secure inpatient treatment, could be transferred to England or are being transferred to England. Is that a capacity problem in Scotland, or
yes,
what's the situation
there? It is, yes. If you look at the Barron Review, they recommended that the state hospital re-established itself as being able to take high secure forensic women, and it's because if they are, then they have to go to Rampton or go to England.
Right, so there are facilities in Scotland, but they're full, or they're not facilities?
They're not. At the moment, the state hospital does not take women, and the Barron Review looked at that and suggested that they should, in future, take women.
And what are the consequences of sending people to England?
In terms of psychiatric care, good, mm-hmm. but away from family, away from friends, away right. from a familiar environment.
Okay. So. That's helpful. I'll let others come in, maybe come back later, if that's okay.
Okay, thanks, Jamie. Just to mention that I think we will be coming back to some questions about private prisons in due course, but it just, I think, in follow-up to some of Jamie's earlier questions, I think, Pauline, you were wanting to come in, and then I'll bring in Fulton after that, Pauline.
Thank you very much. It was a follow-on from Jamie Green's question, because when I read the papers, the one jumped out at me of all the alarming things I read was what you had to say about the heightened risk of prisoner disturbances. You didn't mince your words there at all, did you?
Because I think there is a heightened risk, I really do. But, I mean, I'm well aware that everybody's aware of that risk. The prison service have been working flat out to develop contingency plans, you know, looking at extreme measures if necessary of involving the police. I'm aware the Scottish Government is aware of it. You know, I do know that they're looking in every way mm-hmm. at how they can mitigate it, prevent it, make sure it doesn't happen, and if it does happen, what they do to manage it. So
yeah, I'm sure you're absolutely right. But I just wanted to get on the record, which is what I think I'm taking from this. I wanted to make sure that I've understood correctly. So you've said that adverse prisoner reactions are both traumatic and costly. You see in your submission, the cost of prison riots in England between April and May 1986 were estimated by the government to be in the region of £5.5 million. And in the case of a riot in HMP Birmingham 2016, it's cost the government and the private sector operator £6 million. But you've said in your submission that there's a financial consideration here, as well as a public safety consideration.
Yes.
And I'm taking that from what you've said, and I just wanted to get you to speak to that.
Yes.
Do you have any further concerns that, I mean, the fact you put it in your submission, I have to draw a conclusion that it is a big concern of yours that if this flat budget is not adjusted, then we may have to face that possibility.
I think you're under real pressure financially, and you're going to have to take tough and hard decisions. But it really worries me about community safety. You know, what you hope... I mean, the current recidivism rate isn't very hard to tackle. I find it difficult to get the exact figures. But, you know, if we gathered the how many people return to prison within 2 years statistic, which is quite an interesting one, and then you can benchmark with many other countries... How much of the people not coming back into prison is because of the work that's been done in prison, you know? And if we're taking all that away, then we're then putting people back in community that will commit more crimes. You know? And at the end of the day, it's the victims that are important here, you know, and it's not just the victims who are the subject of crime, but many, many people in prison, particularly women, are themselves victims. You know, and I just think it really worries me that if we're going to strip away all the good stuff, what you're releasing back into the community, because most people are released back into the community, are people who are angry, and that's not fair on the community.
So given what you've said, if... The Justice Committee, and it has still half its discussion about how it responded, if the Justice Committee was to say, amongst other things, the issue that you raise here about the extras that prisoners get keeps the prison regime quiet or in check, and the legitimacy issue, I thought I picked up on that word quite strongly, if the Justice Committee were to say in its report that they felt these were important factors from your submission for the government to take into account when they are considering what they might strip away, you'd be pleased to read that, presumably.
Thrilled. Absolutely thrilled.
Thank you very much.
OK, thanks. I'm going to test Fulton's patience and I'm going to just bring in Rona, but then I will hand over to Fulton after
just
Rona.
Thanks, Convener. Just a very, very quick follow-up, really, from following on from Pauline's line of questioning about prison disturbances and the high risk, etc. Can you maybe just clarify what would lead to that then? So would it be lack of purposeful activity, more restrictions? You know, what impact would lack of finances make to lead to that, if you could maybe outline a few instances?
If you look at prisons, at the moment, if you're on remand, or certainly pre-COVID, if you were on remand, you weren't entitled to go to many activities, and you certainly weren't entitled to get paid for them, and that's in the prison rules. So you're already taking people who are tangling with the criminal justice system. They've already got themselves into prison on remand, and you're not tackling the criminogenic need. Obviously, you can't tackle the offending behaviour because they're still innocent. But you can tackle substance misuse, you can tackle education, you can tackle developing a work ethic, you can tackle housing, you can tackle legal issues. There's so much you can do. If you then add to that that you're taking the convicted population and you're saying, we're really restricting your ability to go to the gym, to go to work, to go to do all the other things, then all of those criminogenic factors that led those people to tangle with the police in the first stage are not being addressed, which means that they then go out and are, frankly, likely to do the same thing again. I always think of me and chocolate. You know, I'm a complete addict with chocolate, and I give it up now and again, and then I go back to it. You know, I've never actually altered my behaviour enough to give up chocolate. Mm-hmm. And so if I can't do it, then what hope have you got if you're living in a society that, or living in your own little group of society, where poverty, drugs, lack of education, lack of a work ethic are sheer indicators of why you tackle in the criminal justice system already? So it's a captive audience theory, isn't it? But it's something I do believe in.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much. Fulton, over to you.
No problem, Convener. Thanks very much. My question, and good morning, Wendy. My question actually goes back to Katie Clark's line of questioning a wee bit ago, and that's around the reform and how possibly some upcoming reforms that this committee will be looking at could link into the budget process that we're here to obviously talk about. So very, very soon we'll be starting the bail and release from custody bill that you'll be aware of a fairly big impact, I imagine, on the or it's intended to have a fairly big impact on the prison population. I'm not sure. We obviously need to wait and see how it'll pan out. And then a bit later on in this term, the proposed criminal justice reform bill, which I think's, you know, a wee mix and match of various things that have been talked about for a while, as Katie Clark said. Have you got any thoughts? I'm not really wanting you to speak about those bills as such, because they'll go through the normal process and the bail one will be starting soon. But just if you've had any early thoughts, either through your own self or through discussions with the prison service, how these might impact budget implications for the... or is it too difficult to say just now, but, or is there any thought about it? And so really in terms of the budget.
I'm hoping it leads to a reduction in budget. To have alternatives for decision makers to actually put someone on a tag, to look at a bail hostel, to look at residential rehab, so that they don't have to go to prison. All of those are cheaper options. Mm. So I really hope that the bail and release bill actually allows the possibility to reduce the budget, you know, properly. I haven't done any of the financial working on that. Frankly, I don't have time or the expertise. But it to me, it's self-evident that if we can reduce the remand population and increase the bail and the tag population, we will have achieved an overall reduction in the budget. So I'm very much in favour of it, or broadly in favour of it. So
Yeah, and I think that would seem to be the government's move in that direction as well. And obviously we'll scrutinise that more as it comes through. But do you feel then that given this bill is coming up before Parliament shortly, do you think it's too early though for the flat cash settlement? You know, the bill would need to be through and in operation, or do you feel that there's a hope that this bill could inevitably reduce the budget, and that's perhaps why the flat cash settlement is there for the prison service?
Wouldn't it be wonderful if it could reduce it enough that the flat cash settlement is only for 1 year? But I haven't done the impact assessment on that, and I don't think anybody else has. No. So, but it needs to be done. I always think of justice as a pipeline, you know, so what you put in at one end, where does the impact further down the road? You know, and the problem with having alternatives to remand is that the return on investment isn't going to be fast enough for a flat cash budget. And that's the bit that worries me. Yeah, so.
Okay, thanks for that. Convener, I do have one other area of question, but I don't know if you want me to do it just now or later on.
Maybe wait till later on, if it's a separate sort of issue.
It is a separate issue.
Yeah, okay, I'll bring it in later on. Okay, I'm now going to bring in Russell Finlay, and then I'll come in with some questions about efficiencies. Russell.
Thank you very much. I'd like to just continue in the line of questioning in relation to Greenock Prison. I think you said something along the lines of if you go back in there and it's in the condition it was in before, you would bring the HSE in with you, and then you suggested to Jamie Green that if it was particularly bad, you would be happy to see it, not happy, sorry, but would be willing to see it closed down if need be. Does the HSE have that power?
I think they do, but I wouldn't be able to say that. I wouldn't be able to say under which article that they would be able to do that, but I would need the evidence to back up my recommendation, which is why I would need the HSE.
Right. Is that the first time you've even considered the likelihood of having to close a facility?
Yes.
Okay. So why has it got into such a poor state?
I'm not sure why it's got into such a poor state. And when I spoke to the facilities maintenance manager at the last inspection of Greenock, he wasn't sure either. They have a problem with damp coming through the walls, and they don't know why or why they can't stop it. You know, so they've put a huge amount of effort into all sorts of technical solutions to identify the reasons of why it's happening.
In relation to Berlini, I was speaking to a prison officer who's echoing much of what you've said about the state of the facilities there. And they were speculating how much money is currently being spent. I think you might have referred in passing to how much was being spent in keeping it functional. Do you have any figures? And in addition, do you think this is really throwing good money after bad? Or is there no real option, that there's nothing else they can do?
I don't have the figures, and any figures I do have would be phenomenally out of date.
Right.
But the reality is, it's throwing good money after bad? Yes, at the moment, but there is no option. You know, there is nowhere else in the prison estate that could cope with the numbers of Berlini were you to close Berlini. Plus, it's a well-run, organised, slick operation. You know, it would be... I think we have to wait for HMP Glasgow.
Right, which is expected
when? 2026.
Do you believe that's likely?
I think it's likely to slip to 2027.
Right, OK. Can I ask about Kilmarnock also?
Yeah.
I was going to ask about Kilmarnock Prison. Again, you've said already, I'll quickly summarise that it's being transferred into public ownership. It's currently well run, very well run. You believe that the decision to do this is ideological. Earlier this year, I had a conversation with some prison officers who represent staff at Kilmarnock, and they said that it costs something in the region of £20,000 per annum to keep a prisoner there, whereas it's about 38 in the public estate. They also said that Serco had offered to build a 300-bed replacement facility as part of a continuation of the contract, and this was rejected by the government. They couldn't understand the logic behind that. I suppose the question is, the deal is done, or is there any way, do you think, of going back in that or revisiting it?
I feel very awkward here because I am an ex-Serco member. There is, of course, a way of going back on it. You could delay it, given that you're looking at a flat cash budget for 4 years or 3 years or whatever. You could delay it for 3 or 4 years. So you would need to negotiate with the special purpose vehicle and Serco to do that. But, I mean, that would not negate your belief that it's the right thing to do, but you could delay it while you're in financial concerns.
So given these extreme budget realities facing the prison service, it's doable. There's the ability to pause the transfer, at least in the short term.
Yes.
Yeah, OK. Now, in addition to that, you also referred to Audit Scotland and the cost of the transfer. And one cost I think has been overlooked is not just staff wages, but pension costs. Can you quantify that in any way? And you referred to Audit Scotland. Have you spoken to them directly about this?
I mentioned it to them, yes, because I felt it was something that should be looked at. You know, when we've got a fiscal challenge, then any costs need examined, don't they? So, yes. So let me explain why it's going to cost so much, having done it. Okay, so private sector staff, and Serco in particular, because I used to work there, work 40 hours a week. Prison staff work 37 hours a week. That's a three-hour shortfall. In order to put them onto prison service terms and conditions, you're going to have more staff to cover off the three-hour shortfall. Private sector staff get free meals. You're going to have to buy that out. Their children get Christmas parties. You're going to have to buy that out. You're going to have to replace all the uniform. You're going to have to replace all the IT. You're going to have to rebrand the place. You're going to have to train every single member of prisoner-facing staff. Private sector staff can't use batons. Prison officers can and must be able to use them. You're going to have to put all that training in place. If Kilmarnock runs on lower staffing levels than I think the unions would like, I can't speak on their behalf, you may get a demand for additional staff on top of the staff you're going to have to get because of the three-hour gap. And also, private sector staff have shorter holidays, so you're going to have to cover all of that. That's where the costs come from.
And it's probably possible, but is there a figure that you have?
I think you're going to have to get that properly costed. And I out of plucking out of the air, off the top of my head, I think you're looking at 10 to 12 million.
Right, OK.
And while that's not a huge amount in the overall prison budget, it's a lot. Remember also that you've got, when you have a DCMF contract, design, construct, manufacture and facilitate, that what you're doing is you're buying the building as well. So they've had a 25-year mortgage. So, you need to look at, when you look at costs, you need to bear in mind that mortgage capacity. Yeah.
But just final point on that very quickly.
Very quickly, because there's quite a number of other questions.
Given HMP Kill and what come out of the Serco are offering to build a new facility, presumably if the transfer takes place, given the budgetary issues, there will not be a new facility.
I think if they wanted it, I think you could pick up the facility. I think the problem is the facility would have, again, a mortgage cost included in it. So.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm going to bring in Colette. I think you're wanting to ask a follow-up, and Fulton, and then I will move on to bringing in Katie to pick up on the private prison estate. So Colette, then Fulton.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, Wendy. Just touching upon what you just said there, Russell, about the transfer over, and forgive me if I'm wrong on this, and maybe you could clarify that, is that if you were to transfer those private staff from Serco over to Her Majesty's service, then the pension costs involved in that, there, when you took your staff over, I know that I'm sure for certain that the pension is ring-fenced out with TUPE, and obviously it costs a significant lot more the pension going into the public pension schemes?
It certainly will add to the cost, you're absolutely right, yes.
Okay, thank you.
It was just following up from Russell Finlay's line of questioning. I think it's almost created a sort of conflict there, because obviously that as a committee and the role that the government are looking at just now, we want to try and find ways to save costs, but a lot of the cost implications of the transfer over seem like things that, you know, most of us would probably support. So you mentioned more training, better holidays, you know, better pay as well. So, you know, as politicians, we would want to support that as well. So it's not, I suppose it's really just more for a comment than anything else in the interest of time, but I just wanted to comment on that. I can see, obviously, knowing that that's...
I think the pay is comparable. My memory is, don't quote me at all, but I know in Addiewell, we were just asking about that yesterday, and they say their prison officer pay, basic grade prison officer, is the same pay as the Scottish Prison Service, or comparable was the word they used. So.
Yeah, but when I suppose my point is, when a lot of the cost implications are, you know, projected to be around improvements for the working lives of people, you know, it's a difficult one for us to be against in that sense, if that makes sense. But I do also hear that Kilmarnock is very well run as well, so I think that's worth knowing. But that was it, Convener.
Okay, I'll bring in Katie Clark just to pick up on some of the prison, private
and
prisons.
Some of what I was going to ask has already been covered, but I mean, is it fair to say that the reason that Kilmarnock's cheaper is mainly to do with the terms and conditions of the staff there and indeed staffing levels? I think you said that you think pay might be comparable, but it may be some of the other terms of and conditions which are less beneficial for staff at Kilmarnock than maybe in the mainstream prison estate. Is that fair? And also, what I've always heard about Kilmarnock, this is my understanding, so my understanding has always been that the staffing levels are poorer, particularly at night, and that the reason that it may be cheaper is that they employ less staff, as well as the staff having poorer terms and conditions. Are those the main reasons? And I ask because you obviously do have a level of knowledge about the place, given, you know, your past role there. And I do have a sort of further question about Kilmarnock, but if maybe you could respond on that first.
Certainly in terms of pay and conditions, I don't think the pay, I can't talk about the pay with any degree of accuracy. Certainly they work a longer working week by 3 hours or so, and certainly they have less holidays. So, yes, no question. Yeah. But in terms of the staffing levels, I think you have to remember it's a modern prison. I know it's not modern anymore, but it was when it was built.
CCTV,
so to compare the staffing levels of a modern prison in comparison to a Victorian prison is an unfair comparison. It's apples and pears. Mm. So although the staffing levels might appear low, you would have to compare it with Lomas and Grampian rather than trying to compare it with any of the other prisons.
Yeah, because there's technology such as CCTV, etc. in place. Yeah, I understand the point you're making. What we've been told and what my understanding is that, and you may know about the contracts, in particular in relation to Kilmarnock, but maybe the other private prisons as well, is that there are guaranteed cost of living increases built into the contracts. So in terms of the real challenges we face now, across the prison estate, given the size of the budget cuts that are being proposed, is it the case that those private sector prisons will have a level of protection, and therefore it will be the mainstream estate that will have to take a greater share of those budget cuts? Is that your understanding of how it's likely to operate?
Yes. Yes.
That's helpful to know. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Katie. I wonder if I can just come in at this point and ask some questions about efficiencies and scope for efficiencies, and what your views are on sort of whether the Scottish Prison Service has got scope to put efficiency savings and measures in place. So, for example, through perhaps investment in alternatives to custody, which we've already discussed, spend to save projects. And, you know, you've indicated this morning you're very cited on sort of current research in and around prisons in Scotland. So whether efficiency savings might not just be about saving money, but also might be an opportunity to enhance our prison estate within Scotland, bring in some contemporary practice, for example. So I'm quite interested in your views on that.
I've always been a huge fan of information communication technology. So when I ran a number of prisons in England, I introduced technology into those prisons. So as an example, when you collect your keys, the good old days, you had someone behind a glass door, you'd drop a tally down, you'd collect a key, collect a radio, requires two members of staff. All day, that's three members of staff. So introducing the key VEN system, which was one of the first things that was introduced, immediately you got a staff saving. It's also safer. I then introduced in-cell telephony about 20 years ago in England. Am I that old? Anyway, you know, and that's now coming into all the prisons in Scotland. I think that's really important in terms of keeping in touch with your family. And it needs to be a time that's right for your family, be able to say goodnight to your kids, being able to phone your mum in Outer Mongolia or whatever. You know, those having that facility in cell telephony is just common humanity. It's really lovely to see that coming in. The next stage for me would be in cell computers. So I do not mean surfing the web, you know? But I do mean that if you start a class in the education facility, that at night when you're locked in, you can carry on working and you can do that. You can book your own visits. You can choose your menu. You can buy your own canteen goods. You can put a complaint in. You can, you know, it's going to reduce the administrative burden. When we introduced that in one of our prisons, we saved £4,000 a month on paperwork. That was a huge cost saving on stationery. The phones and the computers paid themselves off in 2 years. So in terms of investment to save, but there are other advantages. You know, if you are going to be booking a healthcare appointment, the nurse can phone you in cell and say, how are you? Let me triage you over the phone. You can do a kind of triaging. Social work can talk to you. You can talk to them. You know, there's huge advantages, computer-based cognitive behavioural therapy, you know. But the big one, you've been in prison 27 years, you come out. If you can't use a smartphone or you don't know how to access stuff on the web, you're in trouble. It is an absolutely essential skill these days to be able to do your own research and go online and do things. You know, even to use your washing machine requires a degree in technology, I sometimes think. So, yeah. So for me, I think that's one area. Mm-hmm. And within that, if you look at the creativity that happened in COVID, one of the things the prisoners are telling us is that they quite liked being locked up in the evening. They felt safe. They like having enough activity during the day that in the evening could just be family visits, bearing in mind lots of kids are at school, they can't come during the day. You know, to have actual purposeful activity in the evening rather than the random recreation, everybody out playing pool. You know, I mean, how many of us do that at night? So I think there are efficiency savings that can be made that have to be jointly done with other alternatives. If we're locking down every prison at night, say from 6 or 7 o'clock onwards, you have to be able to use the phone. You have to be able to continue learning and you have to be able to come out and see your kids in the evening. So, you know, there are efficiency savings that can be made. Video technology, let's look at that. Video courts. Why are we transporting so many people to court who then aren't required and have to be transported back? You know, let's look at how technology can do to actually develop those efficiency savings.
Thanks very much. Can I just ask a follow-up question in relation to that? I might be slightly straying off budget, but I'm going to ask it anyway. You spoke about and you gave some examples of interaction with staff, so whether that's healthcare staff or prison staff. My slight concern in certain care settings is that sometimes over-digitising and the over-introduction of technology can separate staff from people in their care, and I've got a personal family experience of that. Mm-hmm. So I'm just interested in your views on where you place that decision making between making improvements and efficiencies, but at the same time maintaining those really important elements within the prison setting, one of which would be actual face-to-face interaction with staff.
One of the reasons COVID was so successfully managed and that people were prepared to tolerate those locked-up conditions was not only that it was seen as legitimate because they could see on the TV it was happening to everybody, but also because of really good staff-prisoner relationships. That really makes a big difference. I would be very concerned if the staff-prisoner relationships were compromised by a flat cash budget. Do I think digitisation does that? No, I don't. If you take away the administrative burden of getting the canteen sheets in, transcribing them onto a computer, you know, getting the requests in, transcribing those onto a computer, because the prisoners do all that for themselves, A, you're building personal responsibility, but you're also freeing staff time from mundane administrative tasks. One of the things that really needs to be capitalised on is those staff-prisoner relationships. Integrated case management, working with people to work their prisoner journey through and out the other side. When you look at the desistance theory, time and time and time again, people say, I had a really good relationship with X. Sometimes it's a girlfriend. You know, and that actually made me change my whole life and thinking. An awful lot of that is staff too. And actually freeing up time for them to do more of the case management and less of the administrative burden is absolutely worthwhile. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've looked at Lelystad prison in Holland, but they have a pre-release centre where it's completely digitally run. It's very cheap to build, very cheap to run, 300 prisoners, 3 staff. But it's completely digital. But it can only work because in the previous part of that prisoner's sentence, they had strong relationships with staff. Yeah. And when they're on the pre-release journey and on the way out, they now need to build a relationship with the family and the community. So it's a very different concept.
Yeah, thanks, Mindy. That's really interesting. We're just almost on the hour, but if you're happy to bear with us, I know that there are some more questions that members would like to ask. So I'm just going to hand over to Rona Mackay to pick up on mental health.
Thank you. Yes, thanks. I'd like to ask a wee bit more about health and mental health, and I know we have touched on that. Your submission states that discussion on alternatives need to take place between health and justice around the safe and appropriate location of prisoners with mental health issues. I'm thinking particularly about the number of women, and I know that you've been, you know, very outspoken about this, and a shocking statistic that I read was that 80% of women in prison have brain damage due to domestic abuse, which clearly prison is no place for them. So I'm wondering if you could maybe expand on what you mean by alternatives to prison, and how this can be achieved given the financial pressures that are here today. And second part of the question is, you also say that you would approve of a consideration of a dedicated aged care prison facility,
yes.
Presumably to deal with a number of older prisoners and ageing population. I wonder if you could maybe expand on that and basically to say, you know, in an ideal world, what could be achieved, but what realistically can be achieved given the financial pressures?
I think the women's custody units are a huge step forward and something Scotland is going to be incredibly proud of. I really do. I've got a number of people who are asking to come and see it. Chief Inspector of Prisons England, for example, Chief Inspector of Western Australia. Just delighted that we've gone that far and they want to come and see it working in action. So, you know, I think those are a huge step forward. All you need to do is visit a prison and go down to the segregation unit and you will see significant evidence of mental ill health. Whether or not they're capable of being treated is not a decision that we can make. It is clearly a clinical decision. But you don't have to be anything other than a compassionate human to go and have a look and see for yourself. It is really disturbing many, many, many ways, the amount of mental ill health that is held in segregation. So there's that issue. I've always felt that we should be able to have a step-up, step-down facility for mental health. So something between a prison and a state hospital, or somewhere in a prison that is, to use the old-fashioned term, an asylum for people who are mentally unwell and cannot cope in the community or in prison. There does need to be some thinking about that, you know. I just think it needs to be thought of, and we need to think about it. And whether or not it could be a cheaper alternative is something we also need to think about. So mental health is worrying. There does appear to be a massive problem in the NHS in terms of mental health waiting lists, in terms of mental health beds, and the option, the safe option for the communities, they end up in prison. And that's sad. So the other question was...
Just on that, can I maybe just ask you, for women with, let's say, not severe mental health issues, but clearly do need holistic care, what would you like to see put in place for that, so that they don't automatically go to prison for, more minor offences caused by mental health issues? But they need care, not necessarily, serious institutions.
I do think there needs to be a step-up, step-down facility, I really do, which it caters for that precise group of people, of which there's a vast number in prison. Prison's expensive, psychiatric care is expensive. If you could have a step-up, step-down facility, like the old-fashioned bail hostels, supervised and supported. The family rehab for substance misuse, inevitably, we'll be having people with mental health issues as well. Comorbidity is a huge issue. I just think that's a huge step forward. Hooray, let's get that going. Something else we can be proud of.
So, and I know there are a number of third sector agencies who do a lot of good work with women, particularly being released from prison. The other part of my question was about the dedicated aged care prison facility. Is that, are you suggesting a separate prison for older prisoners?
Yes. Mm. Yes. The reality is the vast majority of aged care people are, because there are longer sentences and they're ageing in prison. There's a higher degree of historic sex offenders who come with long sentences. It's a real problem. Yeah. I think there is a real need to recognise that we need to deal with it. Mm-hmm. I'm not wholly sure if you're wheelchair bound and you've got dementia that you actually need the very secure confines of a prison.
Would you see that as part of a more, you talked earlier about a radical prison reform?
Yes.
That could be a core part of it, I guess.
Yes, yeah, very much so.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. Jamie, are you wanting to come in on this?
I think Ronan Kai's covered. I did have a question about the comment you made around a separate prison for aged those with, for example, physical medical difficulties. And I think we actually saw some of that in practice when we went to Sawton, for example, how difficult it is, and the modifications needed in quite old buildings, actually, that maybe a dedicated facility might be better served. But I guess if we're not building prisons in Dumfries or Greenock, it's hardly likely we're going to start building specific
cohorts. But you
cohorts.
Could convert areas of prisons, or you could look at an old people's home and putting a fence around, that kind of thinking. If
radical,
you're talking about
people
who are physically disabled and or dementia, the risk is not, they're hardly likely to escape. Do they really need high security, prisons? Yeah. So I think there are opportunities.
I think, unfortunately, COVID taught us that many care homes felt like prisons for many of their patients, unfortunately. So I wanted to just ask, we're obviously talking about pre-budget scrutiny, and you mentioned in your very opening comments around not just prisons, although we've focused our comments on prisons, but the wider justice sector, all areas of the justice sector facing the same potential outcomes, and that's community justice, the police, the Crown Office, and other stakeholders who are all parts of the cog in the wheel. Now, I think if we end up in the scenario where the government finds extra money to give some of these services on the back of evidence that they've heard in this committee, it's very likely that much of it will get sucked up in simply pay rises, because that's the largest source of outgoings for many of these organisations. Do you have any concern that even if we don't look at flat cash, there is some additional year-on-year rises in their budgets, and all of that is indeed sucked up through negotiations with workers, or to avoid industrial action, which is a real potential across the board? None of the good things that any of them want to do will happen anyway, even with an increase in budget. What's your advice to government
in
that respect?
No, I don't, because you've got a really committed collection of people who are intent on justice reform. You know, you look at Community Justice Scotland, you look at the Courts and Tribunal Services, you look at the Crown Prosecution Service, look at the police. They are all keen for justice reform. They really are. They would all like to see the remand figures going down. They'd all like to see mental health people handled, people with mental illness handled differently. They would all like to see the prison population coming down without in any way inhibiting the ability of the police to catch and convict, and without in any way inhibiting the ability for the sheriffs to be able to send dangerous people to prison. Mm-hmm. So
I think
there's a real... I think COVID had the advantage that it developed a creativity. Mm-hmm. And actually, if we let the creativity run and we look at 4 or 5 costed options that will reduce costs but will bring around better facilities, I think it can be achieved. I really do.
I think the problem is that much of what they're asking in terms of those upgrades or improvements all cost money and will require a capital budget, which, you know, very few of them believe they're going to get. So with all the will in the world, increasing the resource budget will keep people happy but not necessarily invest in things, which is what they need. That's the concern.
I think there are ways and weeds around that. There are times to look at the third sector, and there are times to look at what we already have and how it can be repurposed. Mm-hmm. You know, so, yeah, I really think it does require a radical rethink, and you get a think tank in, and at the end of 2 days they come up with 3 or 4 ideas that get costed. But, you know, I do think it is possible to take what we have and repurpose it to a cheaper, more cost-effective and better system.
Thank you.
It's Jamie. Colette, I think you'd like to come in and ask some questions about transport.
Yep, thanks, Convener. Wendy, in terms of, you touched upon it in your submission as well, that the current contract for the prison transport service, the cost model is no longer fit for purpose. And you mentioned the court backlogs, in terms of increased hospital bed watches and virtual courts and whatnot as well. Could you maybe just expand on that and see what we could do better? Now, I understand the contract at the moment is 8 years. So how that's an efficiency in itself, if you like, if we could get out of that contract. Could you maybe just explain and expand on that?
Yes. So GeoAmey currently is failing, it's as simple as that. And I don't think I'm saying anything that everybody doesn't know. So the amount of hospital escorts that they're not achieving, the amount of times they're late at court, the amount of inter-prison transfers that they're not achieving. I worry about the hospital appointments being cancelled. I think that has got the potential for being very dangerous. The prison service are picking it up. They will have to, and they are, looking at the contract and seeing what they can do. Now, GeoAmey are struggling to keep and maintain, recruit and retain staff. You know, they are so many staff down that they cannot run the service. And they, unfortunately, are seen as a stepping stone to the police and the prison service. So they train staff up, they're really good, and they disappear. So, I don't envy them. They've got every intent to try and do as good as they can. But they are not succeeding at the moment, and they have not done, actually, for some time. It's been very much a sine wave of performance, and for us, quite worrying. If the contract isn't working, there has to be a plan B. And the contract will allow for a plan B. So, you know, the prison service was going to have to think very carefully about what that plan will be. You know, whether it's going to step in, as in, you know, take over the management of it, how much would that cost? Cancel the contract, how much would that cost? Run it, you know, amputate various services, how much would that cost? So, and run it themselves. So they, I know they're looking at that now, because both GeoAmey and the Scottish Prison Service want to improve the whole service delivery, and it's not just a single problem. You can fine GeoAmey all you like, but if it still means the hospital transport is cancelled, the impact is huge. So therefore, they're both looking at it together to try and resolve it. And there are ways and means contractually to make that happen.
I know from, as well, being an ex-IPM and picking up some casework to do with...
And a good IPM, by the way.
Thank you. Top of the best, believe me. a few of the cases that came forward was to do with transportation, especially when you mentioned already about the ageing demographics of some of the prisoners and when they're being transferred. So, for instance, like if one of them's in shots and they're having to go up to court or whatever in Inverness or something like that, if they're stuck in a cage, basically, within this transportation, and they could be sitting there for quite a length of time. How can that change? What's the impact there on their human rights as well? There,
huge. I mean, unfortunately, we're in the middle of looking at that, and we're developing a series of case studies of concern. 16-year-old held in a van for 5 hours before he gets to Polmont at 10 o'clock at night. Things like that. A woman transported up to Wick, 5-minute court appearance, 5-minute back. The growth and growth of video courts is one of the options. You know, it really has to be. And I know there's some reluctance around that, but if you talk to the prisoners, they're the only ones I can speak to. I can't speak to the ones who walk in off the street. But you talk to prisoners, they so prefer going to a video court than having to get up early in the morning, travel in a van, sit around in a court custody unit, travel back in a van for a 5-minute court appearance. You know, they just don't like it. And I know there's some barriers to that. There's a feeling that, you know, the defence briefs would rather speak to them face to face and be there beside them in the court. But depending on the diet, obviously, if you're a solemn jury stage, then you need to be there in person. But I think you could radically reduce the amount of prisoner transport by greater use of video courts.
Do you know offhand, Wendy, the cost of the contract for GeoAmey?
No.
Okay.
I think it's a matter of public record, actually. I think you can look at it, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Jamie, do you want to come in on transport? No? Okay, thank you. In that case, I will hand over to Russell Finlay.
Thank you. It's just a question about your submission. It refers to serious organised crime groups and a growing cohort of those prisoners, which in itself brings particular problems, not least the pressure brought to bear on staff to smuggle contraband and the risk of increased violence and needing to keep these prisoners apart. My understanding is effectively right now two major organised crime groups are sent to two separate prisons, but your submission calls for consideration of a SOCG strategy for accommodation, and there are two questions. One is, what might that look like, and what has been the SPS's response to your suggestion?
Absolute agreement. They're looking at it right now. So they're taking their top security people and the people within the prisons, the governors, and looking at exactly what can be done. So while it's two major crime groups, if you like, nonetheless, that could expand to three or four, and then what do you do? The numbers are growing. They're looking at the model in England, which I think it's called a MARSOC in England. They're looking at the English model as what they're doing. They're looking abroad. They'll ask their research teams to look abroad and see what they're doing. So they are taking that seriously, and they are taking that forward. I mean, England has a huge number of prisons. When they first hit very serious offenders, they developed what they called a dispersal system. So they were dispersed into an estate with highly trained staff that had higher security levels. Scotland doesn't really have the breadth of establishments that you could have a dispersal system, but they certainly need to have a serious and organised crime strategy, and they are developing it.
Can I just clarify, what is MRSOC?
I think it's Multi-Agency Risk Serious and Organised Crime Committee.
Wasn't sure if it was a word or an action or something. Yes, thank you. Great. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. I think finally I'm going to bring in Fulton. You've got some questions around interchange with justice partners.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And I wasn't sure if you were going to bring me back in because I think that Wendy has actually already touched on it at various points. But it's a question that we've been asking the other panellists through the pre-budget scrutiny process, and that's the interplay with other justice agencies, and I know you've touched on it at various points, and that's if there's a flat cash settlement going to everybody, you know, prison service, the police, you know, the community justice, etc., etc. What impact do you think that has again on your own in the budget of the SPS?
That's an interesting one, actually. I mean, when I look at the Criminal Justice Board and the Criminal Justice, you know, all the rest of it that works together, and they are working together. I think the prison service can often be the hidden person at the bottom of the pile. You know, they're not as big as the police. They're not as visible as the police, for instance. So it can be difficult. But I do think by them all meeting together and actually beginning to look at the whole process together and the whole issue together, they are no longer the poor relation in the justice field. And that's wonderful. So I think they'll achieve it.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm just going to bring this session to a close.
Can I just make one last comment?
Of course.
I would deeply appreciate if you recognise that I cannot speak on behalf of the private sector and that we are completely neutral on this. So.
Thanks very much. That's noted and on the record. And talking about information on the record, is just to highlight that the reported cost of the eight-year contract with GUMA was £238 million for prisoner escort services. So just to record that on the record. So thank you very much indeed, Wendy. That's been a really informative session. And obviously, if there's anything further that members wish to ask, we'll follow up in writing. So thank you again. Okay. And we'll just have a short suspension to allow Wendy to leave. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, members. Our next item of business today is to review the evidence submitted to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee on the National Care Service Bill and to decide if we wish to take any further evidence. So, for example, one option that we have is to schedule a one-off evidence session on the criminal justice-related matters in the bill, and I refer members to paper number 4. So I'm just going to open it up and ask if you have any specific comments on the proposal to run an evidence session, or if you are agreed that that would be appropriate. Russell?
Yes, thank you. I think just given that one in five of the written submissions to the lead committee relate to criminal justice, it makes perfect sense that we should be taking some kind of proper look at this.
Perfect, thank you. Agreed. Fulton?
Yep, just to say that I agree with that as well. I think that I don't think it would certainly do any harm for this committee to look at it. We would maybe need to have a wider conversation about who we feed back into the Health Committee, but I think that given criminal justice, community criminal justice comes under our remit, I think it's appropriate for us to do a one-off session.
Perfect, thanks Fulton. Anybody else? No. So we're happy that we'll put arrangements in place for a one-off evidence session, and I'll just ask our clerks team to assist with that. Thanks very much. Okay, thank you. So our next item of business today is to discuss recent correspondence that the committee has received, and I refer members to paper number 5. So you'll see that the clerks have suggested some ideas of how we may want to take forward the various issues highlighted, but ultimately, if you've got any specific comments or suggestions on either of the pieces of correspondence, then please come in. So I'll just take each letter in turn, and we'll start off with the letter from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans on facilitating peaceful assemblies in Scotland and the working group work that has been done in and around that. So any members want to come in with any points, or are we happy to note the content? Colette and then Jamie.
Obviously, again, this is a big issue in central Scotland in comparison to elsewhere, especially in light of the sectarianism that goes on, and I know it happens even in East Kilbride quite significantly. But one thing I just wanted to note was that some of the civic and interfaith, the local chapel and the churches are working together to set up, stop sectarianism in schools in particular. And, and one of the reasons they've approached the community councils and the local authorities to seek more funding in order to deliver this to first and second years, because it is a big thing. And I know I'm slightly digressing away from the marches and parades, but they all have an impact there. And it's a really good model that they use. They use transport to take them to maybe different areas or teach them different things about the impact that sectarianism has. Mm-hmm. So, and again, on that particular letter, I'd maybe need some more clarification on where they're trying to move that model to.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks, Colette. I don't think there's anything wrong with highlighting some good work that's going on locally in communities. Mm-hmm. Jamie, and then Fulton.
Well, thank you. Obviously, to thank the work of the working group on this, mm-hmm. it's a very difficult and sensitive issue, not least for members who represent communities in the west coast of Scotland. But it's still a bit unclear from the letter we received what will happen next around some of the proposals. I had some concerns around the suggestion that these decisions will be micro-local and whether local authorities will have new or specific powers in relation to marches and processions, and the consequence of that in that we could look at having quite disparate outcomes for marches of certain types in one part of the country but not another, for example. That also then leaves open the vagaries of how different councils operate, whether they're more member-led or official-led. And of course, bearing in mind that councils come in various shapes, sizes and political colours. So I think I would like a little bit more information as to, it was a little bit unclear from the Cabinet Secretary's comments as whether he supported that proposal. It just says I'm keen to explore if anything is possible and desirable in respect to that conclusion. The phrase used is that improvements could be best handled by local partners, but it doesn't state who those local partners would be and what statutory roles they would play in making those decisions. So there are some people who are disappointed that we won't have a Northern Irish Style Parades Commission, but I understand that the volume in Scotland is much lower than it is. But often the consequences are not dissimilar of them. So I would just perhaps ask that we're kept up to date in any information the Cabinet Secretary can provide on the direction of travel. This would be really helpful.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks, Jamie. I mean, like you, I certainly got the impression that local management, local in participation in decision-making around processions and parades was where the Cabinet Secretary was coming from. And, you know, I mentioned this to colleagues earlier on in the North East. You know, this isn't an issue that is as significant as it is in other parts of Scotland. So that makes sense to me, but thanks for your comments.
Sorry, just to add to that is that it's unclear, for example, and if there is a revision to the process, who would be the ultimate arbiter or what sort of appeals would be in place for organisers of such events where they feel like a decision had been made wrongly at a localised level. If there's no national consistency, how that will be presented at a local level. So I think these all need to be cleared up.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Fulton?
Yeah, so obviously this letter in working group was about parades specifically, but you know, some of the disruption to community that people feel is sectarian. So that's it's part of another attempt to address this absolute stain on Scottish society, which has ultimately led to no firm conclusions. So in that respect, I suppose there's likely to be disappointment, although understanding as well, because when I heard about the group being taken forward, I thought that this might be the end outcome, to be honest about it. So I'm a wee bit disappointed that the group as a whole and the Cabinet Secretary's response does focus on Glasgow. I think that's right. I think everybody from anywhere in Scotland would know that Glasgow would be the most impacted place. However, it must be followed by a very close second by Lanarkshire, and, you know, further to be no mention there other than and other some other local authorities, I think is possibly not taken into account the impact it's having on communities like Coatbridge, Airdrie, East Kilbride, Motherwell, Hamilton, Larkhall, etc. So I think that you know, that could have maybe been recognised a bit more. But local authorities, police and etc. are doing all they can to have that balance between human rights and the right to parade and trying to prevent disruption to communities. So in that respect, I suppose, you know, we've just got to continue to support local partners to move forward. But really just some comments more than anything else, more than any action points, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Anybody else want to come in? No? Okay. Rona.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I would like a wee bit of clarification on some of the points that Jamie raised as well in terms of other parties, even just timescales, you know, how long is it going to take to come to a conclusion? I thought it was a wee bit vague, so...
That's fine. Thanks for that, Rona. I'm happy to propose that we write to the Cabinet Secretary and raise these matters. He has said in his letter that he'll write to us again in due course to update on progress in taking this work forward. But I think there's no harm in us going back in the interim and raising the specific points that members have raised. So thanks very much for that. Okay, and the second letter we received was from the Solicitor General on the Rangers Football Club case. So you'll see the recommendation in the papers that has been made. However, I'll just open it up to members to come in with any comments, Russell.
Yeah, thank you very much. Now, it's worth just noting that this letter has been with us for almost 2 months now, and we were unable to refer to it until now. And its contents are the latest twist in this malicious prosecution scandal. And I was very interested to read confirmation that £15 million has been paid to the administrators, but this has been done with, quote, no admission of liability by the Crown. Now, last week, we heard from the Crown witness, John Logue, who said that payouts are now at £51 million. And we should put on the record that this £15 million is part of that £51 million rather than on top of it. And he also confirmed that the Scottish Government have effectively signed a blank cheque for any other future payouts. And this, of course, been against the backdrop of the extreme warnings about budget cuts across the justice system. I think it's also worth noting that we only get told about this £15 million payout because it had been reported by a newspaper. And this entire scandal has spanned the reign of three Lord Advocates, starting with Frank Mulholland, James Wolfe, and now the reign of Dorothy Bain. It's caused significant reputational damage to Scottish justice. But I think there appears to be a strange and worrying lack of meaningful contrition, explanation and accountability. And I wonder if we should give any consideration to calling the two previous Lord Advocates to give evidence about what's happened.
OK. I'll come back to members who've raised specific points at the end, and I'll bring in Pauline.
Thank you very much. If ever there was a case for changing the rules of privilege in this Parliament to include questions that are sub judice at the moment, it would be this one. I don't think it's good enough that I understand why it's the case. We cannot get accountability for a decision, and I agree with Russell Findlay on this, that's brought the Crown Prosecution Service completely into disrepute. And we can't ask any questions about that for a long time after it's happened and you begin to worry about the quality of the answers you're going to get. So I totally support the notion that when, wherever we can, we should be asking Lord Advocates to come to this committee. I think the committee needs to be the one. Who else will there be that questions the Crown Office on how could such a decision ever come to pass? That we've got, in a sense, the money is an issue to some extent, but in a sense, at the heart of it is why our Crown Office, Lord Advocate, took a decision that is now highly questionable on the face of it, that has been described as a malicious prosecution against these directors. And I think we need answers as to what was behind that, and the sooner we can get them, the better.
OK, thanks very much indeed. Anybody else want to come in? Jamie?
So just to recap briefly an issue, and that's that this the letter almost implies that £15 million is the settled amount. It's nowhere near that, nor is £51 million the end of it, potentially. It states at the end of the Solicitor General's letter that she stresses proceedings remain live, that there may be other ongoing discussions, and indeed the 51 is certainly not a cap on the liability. First of all, on the financial side of it, it's still unclear. Well, it was helpful that the Crown made it clear last week that, that this is not coming from Crown budget, it's especially at a time when Crown budgets are under such pressure or facing cuts. The question remains, though, is where will the money come from? And it's all very well saying that the Scottish Government will underwrite it, but which bit of the Scottish Government, which directorate is it, does the Scottish Government take out insurance in matters such as this? And at a time when ministers are keen to stress how difficult things are financially for the government, I totally understand that. It's perfectly reasonable for us to ask where £50+ million of public taxpayer money will come from to subsidise the payment to the claimants. I also think, aside from the money, which is important, and it's a hell of a lot of money, I have to say, is what lies alongside this, is we've never really got to the bottom of, is why the decisions were taken in the first place. And as Russell Findlay said, why no one was ever held to account. A huge amount of taxpayer money has gone towards this, and no one, to my knowledge, has lost their job. No one has properly apologised for it. And a number of individuals, rightfully or wrongfully, have become overnight lottery winners as a result of it. Something the government must accept that to restore that trust in the Crown and its independent decision-making process, even historic decisions, that some form of inquiry, as independent as it can be, I think must be held at some point in the future. Whether that's in the lifetime of this Parliament or the next, I don't know. But until those questions are answered, I don't think we'll be able to restore that faith.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks, Jamie. Rona, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I mean, I'm struggling to number one, an inquiry would cost more money. So, you know, do we add to the loss? I'm kind of struggling to know what purpose this committee has with it. I mean, I'm not disputing what's been said, don't get me wrong, about accountability and all the rest of it. But given that it's, you know, complicated, it goes back a bit, and, you know, we are where we are with it, is there anything we can usefully add to this? That's my mm-hmm. my thoughts.
Okay, thanks very much. Come back in.
Just very quickly.
Very quickly.
It's worth noting that the Scottish Government have already committed to an inquiry, as much as we've got a proliferation of inquiries already, which are costing a small fortune in themselves. I wonder whether, as a committee, we could, in advance of this ever happening, speak to those directly involved and seek evidence. I don't think we should rule it out. I think it's perfectly within our gift to do so.
Okay, thanks very much, everybody. That's helpful, and it's important that your views are on the record. And I very much recognise the concerns that members have expressed about what went wrong. I do note that in the letter that we received from Ruth Charteris, she does actually refer to the fact that she's very committed to supporting a future public accountability, including the expectation that there will be a form of judge-led inquiry in due course. So my view is that we should await the outcome of that and find out perhaps a little bit more about what the timescales for that will be. In relation to a point that Jamie raised, I think it is important that we seek some reassurance around who pays. The Cabinet Secretary is coming in next week, and that may be an issue that he can be asked some questions in and around. So that would be my proposal at the moment. Okay, thank you. Okay, that completes our public business for today. Our next meeting is on Wednesday, the 16th of November, when we'll hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans as part of our pre-budget scrutiny process. And we will also hear from him on the UK Government's Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill. So, as previously agreed, we'll now move into private session. Thank you.